Alrighty, folks. So now that we've got an understanding of what cloud is, let's talk about the key types and services that you can get access to. So what we'll specifically talk about are the cloud service models, shared responsibility, and the different types of clouds that we can access. To help understand the three main cloud service models, let's walk through an example. Let's say we've got our AussieMart web application, and currently we've got that hosted on premises. Now, to host that web application, just like many other different web applications, there's a range of different common things that we need. For the infrastructure, we're probably going to have some physical infrastructure. So for example, physical hosts, storage, networking, and so on. To host that web application, we're going to be running some sort of server, like Windows or Linux, for example. But to actually have that web application work, we'll need some sort of platform. For Windows, that might be the web server role, such as IIS or ASP.NET. Or for Linux, that might be Apache or Nginx. That is to say that if we have some web application, we need some web hosting capabilities as well. Now, for this AussieMart web store, we're also going to have the code if we manage the solution from top to bottom. We can develop that in whatever language actually suits our purpose, but we'll have some code there that provides features and functionality, and we'll have to write all of that ourselves. Now, that's almost the end of the web application infrastructure, but there is one final responsibility that we need to consider, and that's the fact that once the web application is up and running, we'll need to manage the web application itself. So you might have operations teams and developers all managing the physical through to the code. Then maybe you've got some application administrators who are managing the user settings, the data, access to different features within our application, and so on. So these are the different components that we might consider if we were hosting a web application. And it's quite similar to other sorts of things as well. For example, if we were hosting a file server, we've got the same sort of things that we need to manage. We won't have to manage the code, but we will have to manage some sort of platform, for example, the file sharing capabilities. And the same can be said of databases as well. Once again, we'll manage the physical, compute, and then the platform. What is that database server going to be? Is it Microsoft SQL? Is it PostgreSQL? Or is it any one of the other variety of databases that are available? Whatever sort of service you are hosting, there's a range of different layers that we need to manage when we provide this functionality on premises. But what does that look like on the cloud? Well, this depends on the type of service that you are using. When you use the cloud, you could, for example, use a service that is categorized as infrastructure as service, or IaaS for short. Now, what does it mean if we use a cloud service that's considered to be infrastructure as a service? Really, what that means is it's the cloud provider who is going to manage that bottom layer. They will be responsible for the infrastructure, hence why this is called infrastructure as a service. They'll have to manage the underlying physical data centers, the hosts, storage, network connectivity, whatever sort of physical assets you need to provide this service, they will have to manage. However, we do still need to bear in mind that everything else is up to us to manage. So if we use a infrastructure as a service solution to host our web application, that, for example, would be a Azure virtual machine or a AWS EC2 instance. The idea here is that we don't need to manage the physical, but we do need to manage everything else. So yes, we will certainly reduce the administrative overheads, but we can't forget about the other responsibilities as well. However, with all that being said, there are other options available. When we use cloud, we can also use a service called Platform as a Service, or PaaS for short. Now, you can probably guess where I'm going to start going with this. I'm going to go up the stack. With PaaS, the cloud provider will manage everything from physical through to platform. So in our example, working with a web application, we would no longer have to manage the physical, the server, or the actual web hosting infrastructure like IIS, Apache, or Nginx. That would all be taken care of for us. The installation, the configuration, deployment, patching, and even components of the security will be managed by the cloud provider. Now, yes, we will still have responsibilities. It will be up to us to develop the code for our web application and still continue to configure the user settings, data, and so on. Now, the final service model I wanted to introduce to you is the software as a service model, or SaaS for short. And as you can guess, we're going all the way up the stack here, where we don't have to manage anything apart from the actual configuration of the application itself. So for our web application, this might be, for example, using WordPress.com or Wix.com. The idea here is that all we would do is we would sign up for the web application functionality itself. We might pay for the number of users we have, the amount of gigabytes of storage we use, or the amount of network traffic that we have to our web application. So for example, if we're using WordPress.com or Wix.com, we're really only responsible for configuring what is the actual content of our website, what theme might we be using, what sort of users do we provide access, what functionality, do we have shopping carts, and so on. Now, software as a service is definitely very common. There's lots of other examples that you might have heard of. For example, using Dropbox, a data sharing service where you just pay per user. Or maybe something like Microsoft Teams, where once again, you get access to a range of features and functionality that you do configure for your users, but you don't have to develop the code, manage the infrastructure, and so on. So everybody, that's what we're talking about with the different cloud service models. Infrastructure as a service, where we don't need to manage the infrastructure. Platform as a service, where we don't need to manage everything up through to the platform itself. Web hosting, database hosting, whatever that might be. And finally, software as a service, which is perhaps the more easy to understand when you're just getting started, which is some type of service that you typically just pay per user and you actually only have to configure the features for that service. Now, since we have these different cloud service models available to us, it's important to understand that we are going to have different responsibilities. So there's a range of different things that you can understand that we need to work with, from the physical assets through to the operating system, applications, identities, devices, information, and data. Now, if you are using an on-premises solution, you as the customer will of course be responsible for all of that. However, if we're using infrastructure as a service, or IaaS for short, you're only going to have to manage everything from the operating system up. And as we can expect, when we move to platform as a service or PaaS, our responsibilities reduce. However, what's really important to understand here is that yes, with PaaS, we are going to be responsible for information and data, devices, accounts and identities. But when it comes to the next few things, okay, what we are going to be responsible for will probably depend on the actual platform as a service that we are using. If we are using a PaaS like Azure App Service to host our web application or Azure SQL to host our databases, then exactly what things we need to be responsible for, okay, is probably going to be shared through to the underlying infrastructure, operating system, hosts, and other physical assets that the cloud provider will manage for us. And as we would expect when we move to software as a service, okay, all of that responsibility does reduce. But a really key takeaway here is that you'll see, yes, there are some where the cloud provider is responsible in terms of IaaS, PaaS, or SaaS. But then there are those responsibilities that are going to vary depending on the actual service that we use. And really importantly, you'll see we are always going to be responsible for these top three items. So don't think that just because you move to cloud, you will have no more responsibilities. That's definitely not the case. Alrighty, everybody. So that's the different cloud service models and the responsibilities that we should consider. The last thing I want to talk to you about are the different types of cloud. Now, when I mention cloud, you're probably going to think of one or more of the following: Microsoft Azure, Amazon AWS, or Google GCP. Each of these are an example of public cloud. And they are an example of public cloud because, like we spoke of earlier, when we consider the definition of cloud and the different properties that a cloud provider needs to possess, we know that these public cloud providers provide all of that: broad network access, on-demand self-service, and much more. So those are examples of public cloud. But what can sometimes be confusing is when you hear mention something like private cloud. Now, private cloud is not just your own data center in your own office with your own servers, applications, and other things running there. Private cloud is where you have a solution that provides the exact same sort of capabilities that we have learned about for public cloud, but it does so in a way that is only privately accessible to you. Now, there's a range of different examples of this. Microsoft has a product called Azure Stack that you can deploy on your own infrastructure in your own environment to get all the same sorts of familiar Azure features, capabilities, and services that you would expect if you were using the publicly available service. However, it will be only privately available depending on however you choose to configure your network connectivity. And also, we can see that for both Amazon and Google, there are other private cloud versions of that solution as well. Amazon has AWS Outposts and Google has Google Anthos. So that's public cloud and private cloud. Now, some other types of cloud that you might hear mentioned are hybrid cloud. Hybrid cloud is really where you just use a combination of both public and private cloud within your organization. With the really key thing to remember here that when we're talking about private cloud, we're not just talking about your own data center being connected to the public cloud. We're talking about you using some sort of service like Azure Stack, AWS Outposts, or Anthos in conjunction with the publicly available cloud solutions. And finally, the last term to know about that you're going to hear more and more these days is multi-cloud. Multi-cloud is just where we use two or more of the common public cloud providers within our organization. Okay, everybody, so we've now got the basic understanding of what cloud is, the key features and functionality that it needs to provide, the different cloud service models, and the types of clouds that we can get access to. So thanks so much for joining me. I hope to see you soon in another lesson.